spiritual blessings in Christ. And we're looking at the book or the letter of Paul to the church in Ephesus. All right? In Ephesus, in Ephesians chapter 1, the Apostle Paul was like listing or mentioning one by one our spiritual blessings in Christ. Now, I believe with all my heart that this is something that we need to hear today. We need to hear, what are these spiritual blessings? You know why? Because I think when we think about the blessings, we think about the things that is happening in our lives today. Our mind is kind of like limited by the things that we see in this life. So when you talk about blessing, for example, when you do your praise report in your life groups, you know, we praise God for the health, amen. We praise God for the job, amen. We praise God that our families are together, amen. These are indeed blessings, amen. And this is what we need to thank God for. But here in the book, or in the letter of Paul to the church in Ephesus, Paul is like giving us a more glorious, richer blessings that sometimes we don't see and many times we are not aware of. And he was saying these spiritual blessings in the heavenly realms. When the Bible talks about the heavenly realms, it is not the physical realm, obviously. It's not the material thing, obviously. He's speaking about something that God has done in our lives. And this is what the blessing that the Apostle Paul is trying to expose and reveal to the church and to us today. Last Sunday, we talked about the blessing of being chosen, amen? How many of us have, you know, in our daily life, week after week, month after, how many of us are thinking about us being chosen by God? We don't normally think about it, amen? We all go, Lord, you know, in our praise reports during our life group, I haven't heard. I've been a Christian for many, many years, and I've been through Bible studies and care groups and all those. Whenever there's praise report, I have never heard someone say, I praise God because I'm chosen by God. No one. That means this is out of our radar. This is not in our minds when we talk about blessing. But Paul is saying this is a blessing in the heavenly realms. This is far better, far richer, far glorious than the material things that we could ever have. And today we just want to continue that. And so if I may just suggest and recommend, read Ephesians chapter 1. Read it this whole week. Because that's what we're going to look at in the next succeeding Sundays. Ephesians chapter 1, from verse 3, and I guess up to verse 12, if I'm not mistaken. So today, we will look at verse 4 and 6. Paul is saying, in love, he predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. Would you bow with me for a second as we pray? Heavenly Father, without your anointing and without your work, without your revelation, without the work of your Spirit in giving us the understanding, these things that we will do will amount to nothing, Lord. Apart from you, we cannot do anything. As a Father God, we humbly ask, that you will open the eyes of our hearts. Give us understanding of these spiritual blessings in Christ in the heavenly realms. Lord, we pray that our hearts will be so soaked, Lord God, in this precious truth, that it will impact our lives today in the way we live, in the way we act, in the way we respond to anything that we go through. Father, we ask that you will be magnified. You will be glorified. Your goodness will shine upon the preaching of your word today. We ask this through your Son, and for his name's sake, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. The title of our preaching today is this: you are blessed to be adopted. You say that to the person next to you. You are blessed to be adopted. Say one more time. You are blessed to be adopted. Amen. Everybody knows what adopted means, right?
Amen.
Amen. We all know what adopted means. In the Bible, adoption or being adopted is a glorious thing. It's a beautiful thing. It carries a lot of blessings when we talk about adoption. All right? But unlike today, the word adoption, sometimes the word adoption carry, or in Tagalog is ampon. Would you say ampon, Brother Barry?
Ampon.
Ampon. Ampon. In Tagalog it's ampon. Sometimes, not every time, but sometimes it carries a negative tone. Sometimes it is used as derogatory word. Sometimes it is used to, if someone is adopted in the family and the children that is really the sons and daughters, when they have conflict, they can use this as derogatory word, saying, I'm good kind of people, no? You are just adopted here. So, in a sense, what we're saying is that if you are adopted, then you don't have a voice, you don't have a right here, ampun ka lang. Right? Adopted ka lang. It's kind of like belittling, it's like a word that would even destroy or discourage the adopted person. But not in the New Testament, but not in the time of Paul. Adoption is totally different, it has no negative tone. The Apostle Paul is not ashamed to call himself and to call us adopted. There is no demeaning, there's no belittling. When you see yourself, when Paul sees himself and the church as adopted, he was praising God. There's so much, it's precious. It's carried a lot of blessing, and that's what we're going to talk about today. The blessing. You are blessed to be adopted. We'll talk about the blessing of being adopted by God. And here's the thing. Here's the blessing. In Galatians 4, the Apostle Paul reveals it more in detail. He's saying, but when the fullness of time came, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under law, so that he might redeem those who are under law, that we might, look at that, that we might receive the adoption. That we might receive the adoption as sons. Because you are sons, God sent forth the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Therefore you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. You are blessed to be adopted because, as you see there, you are no longer a slave but a son. Now, the Apostle Paul, writing to the church, he's using a picture here, a picture that is so common in those days. During those times, a third living in the Roman Empire at that time were slaves. There's so many slaves during that time. Now, a slave lives with a family, but slave is not treated part of the family. A slave, in fact, is not even treated as a person during that time. Meaning, a slave can be sold, like you have an iPhone. You want to sell your iPhone? Sell it. It's like a slave is like a material thing. It's not even a person. You can sell it. You can trade. A slave has no legal right. A slave has no freedom. Before the adoption, that's what we are. Spiritually speaking, we are slave. Not literally, no one here is, in fact, everyone that Paul writes to are slave. Therefore, he's really talking about spiritual thing, about being enslaved to the law. He's talking about the law that born under, that we might redeem those who are under the law. Under the law, it speaks about being enslaved to the law. I'd like to explain that a little bit more. When you're under the law, you live under the law. Whatever the law says, that's who you are. You cannot escape what the law says. You are a slave. You're under the law. All right? And so what the law says, you have sinned. That's what the law says. You have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That's what the law says. The law says you are condemned because you have sinned. You are condemned. God's wrath is upon you when you have sinned. That's what it means to be under the law. You're a slave of this. You are living under the law. You're living in guilt. When you are living under the law, you're living because you have sinned. You know you have sinned. You're living in guilt. And when you're a slave, there's no escaping. You live in guilt. You live in what the law says. You are condemned. You live in that condemnation in your heart. Now Paul, listen to this. Paul is telling the church, he's telling us today, the blessing of adoption is this. The blessing of adoption is now you're no longer a slave. You're no longer a slave of this law, meaning the judgment of the law, the curse of the law, which is death and condemnation, no longer applies to you. Why? Because you're now taken up. You've been set free from the law. Now you are a son. All right, now you're a son. It's like, picture it this way, imagine this way. Imagine that a judge, for example, a judge, a ruling judge, you know, declared someone may, you know, committed a crime. Let's say Barry committed a crime, all right? The crime you committed is worth of death, right? The judge said, you have guilty, all right? Death penalty. Alright? That's what the law says. That's this justice of the judge of the law says you will be condemned. You'll suffer the consequence. You're a slave of the law. Now, it's saying now you, when adoption took place, what happens? The judge, because of his mercy and grace, the judge comes to you. For example, you're in the prison cell. The judge came, opened the prison door, the gate, and take you by the hand, Barry, come with me. He said, where are we going, judge? Well, you're afraid, right? Where are you? Maybe you're going to the chair, the electric chair, whatever. But the judge took you to his home. The judge adopted you. He made you his son. No longer now, you're no longer under the law because he set you free. Amen? He sets you free from the condemnation. He sets you free. Now, maybe we will ask, well, how could that happen? Judge should be righteous judge. Justice must be met, right? He cannot just open the prison cell and take you on and make your son. He cannot do that because there is justice. There's a law which says that you must pay the price. What happened? The judge was so merciful. The judge was so loving. He asked his son, son, would you take the place of Barry? Because I love him. I want to adopt him. I want to adopt him as my son. Would you take his place? Would you carry the penalty of his sin, of his crime? And the son said, Father, yes, I will. Not my will be done, but yours be done. So he took your place. That son died in your place. Justice is met. The judge took you by the hand, took you home, made you a son. That's what adoption, that's what Paul is saying here. God who is holy, God who is just, cannot just make you adopted son. Somebody has to pay the price. And we see that there. When the fullness of the time came, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, so that he might redeem. God would redeem those people who's reading the letter of the apostle, who knows what redeem means. You want to have the slave set free, somebody has to redeem, somebody has to pay the price, somebody has to pay something so that the slave will be set free. So Jesus Christ was born so that he might redeem. How did he redeem? On the cross. Tetelestai, I paid it all. Everything. I'm taking the condemnation. I'm taking the wrath of God. And now because Jesus took it,
You are free. You are free. Forgiven. And because you're forgiven, that's what he said. Because you are forgiven, we receive the adoption as sons and daughters. Without redemption, there's no adoption. Without Jesus paying the price, the judge cannot just adopt a criminal. Somebody has to pay the price. Do we have this, church? Amen. That's the doctrine of adoption. Beautiful, isn't it? Beautiful teaching of adoption. The word adoption in Greek is huiophysia. Huiophysia. And this is what it means. Huiophysia means formally and legally declare that someone who is not one's own child is henceforth to be treated and cared for as one's own child. Let me read that. Adoption in Greek means to formally and legally declare that someone who is not one's own child is henceforth to be treated and cared for as one owns child. So, by that definition, it means when God adopted us, it means that God didn't just take us home. God didn't say, okay, now from now on, you're my son or my daughter. By definition of you, who you is, of the adoption, it means now God, our Father, treats you as real son and daughter. And that's a very profound, significant thing. Probably you know of fathers who have sons, but not treating them as sons. You know, just biological father, but not really a father. Now God, when He adopted us, He's not just saying, hey, you're my son. Wala ka sa buhay mo. You know, you go your way. The Father, being a Father who adopted us, now He is a Father who treats us as sons and daughters. Now, I'd like to share with you, in the Scripture, we see God as a Father, how He treats His children. There could be more than this, but in the interest of time, I just want to read you through some text in the Bible that speaks of how the Father in heaven treats us. This is the first one. In Matthew 7:9-11, it says that which of you, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a snake? Now look at that. If you then, talking about the Father, if you then, though you are evil, meaning not good, perfect fathers, if you know how to give good gifts to your children, look at this. Look at how the Father treats them. How much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask Him? Meaning, how does our Father in heaven treat us? Your Father in heaven provides. Say provide.
Provide.
Amen. Isn't that our testimony as children of God? I'm sure you have many stories to tell that God is faithful in providing all your needs. Amen? Amen? We will not have sufficient time if you want to do a testimony here. I'm sure. I have heard some of you say, you know, God really was faithful in the perfect time. God provides for my need. I have my own story to tell. You know, back in Hong Kong, there was a time I lost my job in Hong Kong. And one night, there was a knock on our door. A neighbor friend of ours came and carried a plate of food, you know, for you, Sam, for the family. Now, when I saw that, I was moved to tears. I was like, wow. It's not because we don't have food in our table. We still have food in our fridge, you know. I still have money because I lost my job. I got well compensated. But that's not the point. When I saw the food, it's just like somebody whispered in my ears, a gentle whisper of the Spirit, saying, "I will provide." And during those times, I'm already like getting the impression that I will be going to the ministry. What perfect time by God, saying, "I will provide for you." This is our Father in heaven. He provides. I'm sure all the fathers here, we get that character of God. We fathers here, we provide for our family. Amen? Amen? The fathers here who doesn't provide for his family, in fact, the Bible says, if you don't provide for your family, you are worse than infidel. But we, I can assure myself that all the fathers here are good, faithful, you provide for your family, amen. So that's one thing. Your Father in heaven provides. Jesus is saying, if you're hungry today and you ask your Heavenly Father for bread, for sure your Father, even though he's not a good, perfect Father, he will surely give. How much more your Heavenly Father? Do you have a need today? Call on your Heavenly Father. You are an adopted son. God is treating you as his own son and daughter. Second blessing of being adopted. Your Father in heaven loves you no matter what. As a father loves his children no matter what. Amen? Father, say, would you raise your hand? Is that true to us? Fathers, will you raise your hand? Amen. Amen. You know, how many times we see our children, is who made us. How many times we see our children run away when we tell them, okay, it's your time to wash the dishes. And they just run away and wash, you know, and play their video games. How many times we were so frustrated and disappointed with how our sons behave. Amen. But no matter what, amen, no matter what they do, no matter how they fail, Father's love, Father's heart will say, "I love you still. I love you no matter what you do. My love for you will never change. My love for you will not diminish." And that is our God. That is our Father in heaven. Do you remember the parable of the prodigal son? Amen. What happened with the prodigal son? The prodigal son, the young son, there are two sons, the young and the old. The young son one day asked his father, "Father, give me my inheritance." Do you know what that means? You know, inheritance is given when the father dies, not when the father is alive. And so that young son, when he asked for his father, he was like saying, "Father, I don't need you anymore. Give me my inheritance." All right? And so what happens? Okay, the father is so gracious and merciful. Okay, son, I'll give you inheritance. You know, make us the long story short, the young son went to a remote place, squandered every penny of the money that the father has given. Everything. He lost everything in his sinful habits and desire. So much so that he was so hungry that he didn't even want to eat the things that the pigs eat. Now he came to his senses and said, "What am I doing here? I have a father who is so rich. I have a father who is, you know, even the slave that is not like this." So he said, "Okay, I'll come back to my father. Even though he treats me as a slave, it doesn't matter. I just want to be with my father." Alright? And so this young son came home, and the Bible says in Luke chapter 15, I think, in Luke chapter 15, it says, when the father saw his son at a distance, that is a very powerful statement. When the father saw him at a distance, that means far away. Maybe he was
tiny thing. And yet this Father recognized us. That's my son. Lord, that's my son. It's the Father's longing for this son. This Father is waiting and waiting, expecting his son, but he will come back. He's over me, and yet the Father recognized him. That's my son. And the son was like rehearsing, you know, already what he will tell to his father, Father, I have sinned. You know, please just make me a slave. It's okay for me. When the father saw him at a distance, the father ran to his son. It's not the son running to the father. It's the father running to his son. And what does the father do? The father kissed his son. The father didn't even allow the son to talk about the father who made us live. No, he embraced and kissed his son. Your Father in heaven loves you no matter what you've done, no matter what sin you have done, no matter how insulting your words to God, no matter how you live a life that is, you make your own decisions already, you drift away from God, you stop reading your Bible, you're so far away from God, but your Father in heaven is looking at you with compassion and love that never change. He loves you no matter what. And the moment when you say, the moment your heart desires, I will come back to my Father. That moment your Father embraces you. The Father kissed you. Amen. No questions asked. Why did you do that? Why did you do that? Father just embraced, kissed. Now, this is even more wonderful, because after embracing and after the kissing, the father ordered the slaves, you know, kill a fattened calf, bring a robe, bring the ring, bring the sandals for my son. Robe, ring, sandals, these are not for slaves. These are not for foreigners. This is for the son and daughter. Meaning, when the father embraced his, the father just restored back the son. My son, you are my son. I will always treat you as my son. My love for you will never fail. Your Father in heaven loves you. No matter what. No wonder the Apostle John can say in 1 John 3:1, how great is the love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. Say that to your sibling. You are a child of God. That's what you are. Yes. And if you are a child of God, you have a Father in heaven that loves you no matter what. And it's not the end. There's so much more. There's so much more. Look at this. Third, your Father in heaven gives you inheritance. Did you see that there? The last statement. Therefore, you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir. You know what an heir is? An heir is someone who is appointed to receive inheritance. Sometimes we're not that These words are common to us. But you are an heir. If you are a child of God, you are an heir. I am an heir of God. Now, go back to the parable of the prodigal son. Now we talk about the old son. Talk about the young son, the old son. Now, there was festivities now, there was celebration. And the old son, coming from working at the field, coming and said, what's this? What's happening here? And the slave said, your brother came. When he heard that, when he heard that his brother came, he was so angry. He was so angry that he squandered everything. He has down the, he has down the courage to come back. So he didn't go to the celebration. The father asked him to come. He didn't say, I will not go there. So what the father did again, the father, you know what happened, right? The father came to the old son. For example, it's you, Hallelujah. For example, you're not that old. Yeah. What's happening? You say, I'm slaving for you for many, many, many years. You didn't even give me a celebration. You didn't give me a calf to celebrate with my friends. That's why you're dead to the father. And this son of yours, you didn't even call him by his brother. This son of yours squandered everything that you had given him. He came back, you gave this celebration. You know what the father said? The father said, My son, everything I have is yours. Everything I have is yours. What does it mean? When we are adopted children of God, everything that God has is yours. We need to hear this message. We need to hear this truth. You know what? Because many times when when we're so in need, we have nothing, we have no money in the bank, we don't have a beautiful house, our car is coming down, but we tend to think, I'm not successful in this life. My friends and their mansions, they have a beautiful car, they have a successful job, they are promoted, now vice president and all that, but me, it's so hard to work. It's just paying, just meeting one and meeting something like that. You get your salary and then, and then we think about that, we say, if you are a child of God, think about this. If you are a child of God, if you are adopted child of God, if you have received Jesus Christ in your life as your Lord and Savior, God has adopted you to be a child. Lift up your eyes. Don't look at what you have. Lift up your eyes. Lift up your eyes and see that God is telling you, what I have is yours. Can we imagine that? What God has is yours. And that's true in the scripture. It says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 3, it says, blessed are the poor in the spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. We have the kingdom of heaven. In Matthew 5, it says, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. We will own the earth. We will own the whole creation of God. We are co-heirs with Jesus Christ, which means everything that Jesus had. It's ours. If you are during this summer you go to Banff and Jasper and you're so amazed at the beauty of the lakes and the mountains, praise God, we should because this is God's creation. You know what?
That is just a foretaste. It's just a foretaste of the glory. And that's why in Romans chapter 8, Paul will say, our temporary sufferings on earth cannot be compared to the eternal glory. The eternal glory, my friends, is that we will be with Jesus and enjoy all that God has. Hallelujah. Lift up your eyes. Open your eyes to the spiritual things so that you will not have that self-pity. You don't have your love in discouraged when things are not, you know, you're not expecting in your life. Lift up your eyes and see how rich you are in Jesus Christ. You are rich, my friend. You are so rich. You own the world. If here you own a building, you're already rich, amen? But here you own the earth, you own the creation of God. So that you will enjoy God forever and ever and ever and ever. Isn't our Father amazing? Amen. Our Father is so generous. Our Father is so gracious that He will give everything. He's telling you today, my son, everything I have is yours. Don't look at your savings in the bank. Don't look at your car or your house. Look at this precious blessing. Everything that God has is yours in Jesus Christ. The fourth blessing of being adopted. We see this in the text itself. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, whom we cry, Abba, Father. When He adopted us as sons, God wants us to call Him Abba, Father. You know what Abba means? Oh. Abba is not the word when you are surprised. Abba, you know, Brian. Abba is a wonderful word. It is an Aramaic word. It is a street word during the time. Aramaic is a street word. Which means Abba is used as the way they called their father during that time is Abba, Father. Meaning today it's like saying Daddy or Tatay or Itay. You know, it carries the sense of intimacy and sweetness, Tatay. Abba, Father. And in the scripture, only one person called God Abba, Father. Do you know who's that person? Do you know who's that person who called God Abba, Father? It's Jesus. It's only Jesus, Abba, Father. And now because of this adoption, the blessing of this adoption is now the Spirit is given to us, the Spirit of adoption. We now know that we are children of God. And when we know we are children of God, now we can call Him Abba, Father. Abba, Father. Again, I've been a Christian for a while. I am very observant in how people pray. I'm not judging, right? I'm just observant. And many times I hear people, they don't call God Father. Because they pray, Lord God, you know, God, Lord. That is okay, because God is God and Lord is Lord. There's no problem with that, all right? But Jesus taught His disciples how to pray, amen? When Jesus taught His disciples how to pray, what did Jesus say? Pray like this. Our Father. Jesus is teaching us our Father. He is your Father. Why would you not call Him Father? Yes, you call Him God because He is indeed God. He is Lord. Yes, you call Him Lord. But He is your Father.
So call him, Father. Father, I have a need today, Father. I need your help. Father, I need your help. Call him, Father. Can you imagine, for example, a professional doctor have a son? You know, professional doctor have a son. And one day that son became sick, and he comes to this doctor, his father. Can you imagine the son would say, Doctor, can you heal me? Doctor, can you help me? I'm sick. We can't imagine that happen, right? Though he is a doctor, he will not call him doctor, because he's his father. And he'll say, Father, I need you. I'm sick. Father, help me. And that's how we ought to call God, our Father, Abba, Father, in the sense of that relationship that you know you are adopted child of God. You know that God will provide for you because you are His child. You know that His love for you will never fail. You know that whatever He has is yours. And therefore you call Him Father with confidence that God knows, that your Father knows what is best for you. Therefore you call Him with full trust, Father, I need you, help me. You have that confidence that the Father in heaven will hear you, will provide for you. Isn't that amazing? So much blessing to be adopted. Amen. I pray that we will leave this place today knowing that we are adopted child of God. We will leave this place. I'm a child of God. He's my Father. Amen. Thank you. We will say with the Apostle Paul, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms. In love, He predestined us to be adopted as sons through Jesus Christ, according to His pleasure. Amen. I said earlier, without redemption, there is no adoption. But quickly now, as I close, there's one thing that we have to know. This is something that has been controversial in Christian community. Whenever they hear these words, it's like, they don't need to grasp or to embrace this. I'm talking about predestination. If you're a Christian for a while, predestination is something that divides the Christians on how what they do, what they believe in predestination. But let me just quickly say this in a very simple way. The meaning of predestination. Let's look at the text again. In love, He predestined us to be adopted as His sons through Jesus Christ. Predestination comes from the Greek word proorizo. Proorizo, which means to decide beforehand, to determine beforehand. The word pre means before. And predestined means predetermined or pre-choice or pre-decision. He made a decision beforehand. This is what he's saying. God in love, he made a choice, pre-decided, pre-planned, predetermined that you will be an adopted child of God. The implication is this. What Paul is saying here, if there's no redemption, there is no adoption. In here, he's saying, if there is no predestination, there is no adoption. Because it says there in love, he predestined. And when God predestined, when God predetermined, God will all in His power will make that happen. The redemption is pre-planned. The redemption of Jesus Christ is not a chance. The coming again, we saw it a while ago. that God sent forth in the fullness of time. There is such a time, there is a planning, there is beforehand God already marked that day that Jesus will come and die on the cross for us. Redemption has been planned even before the creation of the world. So much of our adoption, God has already done. In my friends, today adoption will be plan B for many couples. Couples who will not have a child for 5 or 10 years will have a second thought. Mommy, let's go for adoption. You know, I think I will not have any children. Let's go for adoption. It could be plan B. But with God, there is no plan B. With God, this is the plan. This is the plan. God, our Father, didn't make any mistake. It was not a mistake that He adopted us sons. It wasn't like, okay, something's wrong with this character. I better adopt son. No, before the creation of the world, since He predestined us to be adopted, it means even before we were born, we are already in God's heart, in God's eyes. He loved us already, that He wants us to be His sons and daughters. We should not make this complicated, the predestination thing. We just need to know that God beforehand has planned it according to His will, according to His grace. He has set His eyes on you. He wants you to be His child. That's the blessing of adoption. That's the blessing of redemption. That's the blessing of being this nation. I pray that, again, as we leave this place, we will summon the praise like the Apostle Paul. Praise God. Praise God. I'm a child of God. Whatever I go through in this life, I'm a child of God. I am loved by God. He's a good, good Father. That's who He is. I am loved by Him. That's who I am. That's who you are. That's what Christopher even says. Worship Him when you come in.